So the simplest way of going from Kepler's third law to Newton's law of gravity is to start with Kepler's third law, which is expressed here, and assuming circular motion. For circular motion, the great thing is that the period is just the circumference divided by the speed v. So you can also write it in this form over here. And if you rearrange the expression and you multiply by the small mass m, you can also write it in this form. So the next steps are to realize that the right-hand side of the equation is just a centripetal force, and therefore the left-hand side of the equation is gravity, essentially between m and big M, which you don't have here yet. But what you can do is, by understanding Newton's third law, that tells you essentially that the force exerted by small m on big M must equal that of big M on small m. That's the important concept that you need to move forward. And if you interchange small m and big M and introduce a new constant, k prime, say, which is done here, and note that on the other equation we still have k, not k prime, you can very easily reach Newton's law of gravity, gmm over r squared. And you understand that there is a relation between small m, big M, and these two constants, which means that you can also find what big K in this case is, which is 4 pi squared over g. Now, the other thing you should be familiar with, and it should be fairly straightforward for you to do, is to get Kepler's third law from Newton's law of gravitation. It will involve some similar steps. First thing you would probably be doing is to understand that gravity will be working as a centripetal force. So you write down Newton's law of gravitation on the left-hand side here, and equaling it to the centripetal force, that's mv squared over r. And this allows you to also write down the velocity. V squared is gm over r. Again, the assumption to make this thing quite easy is to assume circular motion. If you do that, then you have a clear relation between the velocity, the radius, and the periods. And you can rearrange to essentially find this expression, which is almost there in terms of getting Kepler's third law. You can see you have p squared over here, you have r squared, and you have r. So you can actually manipulate the expression to finally find Kepler's third law and identify this actual constant in Kepler's third law, which actually contains big M. It contains the mass of the sun. That is the reason why, for the solar system, if we use period in years and the distance in AU, because everything's orbiting the sun, we can set this constant to 1 with those units.